Leaving Dublin for a five-day trip to explore Ireland southwest, we often drove over very narrow roads through the pretty Irish countryside. Our first destination was Blarney Castle, just outside the rebellious city of Cork. This is, of course, home to the famous Blarney Stone. We then headed south for the lovely and historic sailing port of Kinsale, long considered to be Ireland's culinary capital. From there, we headed west along the coast, stopping at Charles Fort and the ancient Dromberg Stone Circle. After visiting the old lighthouse at Mizenhead, we went around the peninsula to Bantry House, one of Ireland's most enchanting manor houses. Next, we explored the rugged coast of the Beara Peninsula, stopping to photograph the lovely gardens on Garanish Island. After having tea in the thriving tourist city of Kenmare, we drove the Ring of Kerry to Valentia Island and a boat trip to the Skellig Islands. For the last leg of the trip, we explored the lovely Killarney area, stopping at Dunlow Gap, Ross Castle, Tork Waterfall, and Muckross House. Our last night was spent at the magnificent Adair Manor, just south of Limerick, and the restored medieval town around Bunratty Castle. Originally made out of wood, this castle was first erected in the 10th century. We see here the third castle built in 1446 by Dermot McCarthy, King of Munster. Why is it called Blarney Castle? Queen Elizabeth I coined the name after listening to a long discourse by the owner. Her response was, "Blarney!" According to legend, all who kiss the Blarney Stone will be endowed with eloquence. After ascending the narrow castle steps, I ventured forth to take my turn. As you can see from this script, the legend is indeed true.
The wind blew high, the snow come a-tumbling from the sky. All of Maurice says she'll die if she doesn't get the fella with the roving eye. She is handsome, she is pretty, she is the belle of Belfast City. Let them come whatever they will, for it's Albert Mooney she loves still.
The historic old port of Kinsale is the perfect place to begin our exploration of the southwest. This thriving seaside resort dates back to at least the 12th century and has always been a fishing village and a trading port. During the 18th century, it was established as a first port of call for commerce with America. Charles Fort was the site of an historic battle in 1601, when 3,000 Spanish troops fought alongside the Irish to keep out the British. The British victory here and in other parts of Ireland sent the Irish aristocracy fleeing to Europe, where they remained for several hundred years. The highlight of our trip was a visit to the Dromberg Stone Circle, a set of ceremonial stones probably dating back more than 3,000 years. 13 of the original 17 stones survive. Hundreds of stone circles exist throughout Ireland and the British Isles, and scientists believe that most were used by ancient peoples for astronomical calculations and mystical ceremonies. There is a strange feeling of awe and wonder upon entering the stone circle, and I remained here for a while, walking among the stones and absorbing their energy. Stake Fort dates to about 500 BC. This almost circular stone structure is believed to be the fortified home for several Iron Age families, a clan, and their livestock. The walls are 13 feet wide at the base and 18 feet high, though they may have been much higher in the past. It resides on private farmland, surrounded by grazing sheep, a glorious setting for this monument to the past. Mizzenhead is the mainland's most southern point. The lighthouse was completed in 1910 and is reached by a 99-foot suspension bridge. It was built to save lives off the treacherous coast and was the last landfall seen by many emigrants to the U.S. It housed the first radio beacon in Ireland, erected in 1931, and was one of Marconi's first telegraph stations. We're on our way to Garanish Island, a 10-minute boat ride from Glengariff, the peaceful, wooded, sheltered town favored by Thackeray, Sir Walter Scott, and George Bernard Shaw. Set on the island is Inaculin, one of Ireland's horticultural wonders. In 1910, a Belfast businessman transformed it into a botanical Disneyland, complete with a wisteria casita, a sunken Italian garden, Japanese bonsai specimens, a Grecian temple, and a tower used by the English to watch for attack by Napoleon's forces. Adorned with extraordinary shrubs, trees, and tropical flowers, this is certainly an unexpected treat.
Mamma, ma, will you buy me a? Will you buy me a? Will you buy me a? Mamma, ma, will you buy me a? Will you buy me a banana?
Bantry House is one of Ireland's most enchanting manors, in a picture-perfect setting above Bantry Bay. Built in the early 1700s and expanded later that century, it was the ancestral house of the White family. Due to its strategic position, it was instrumental in repelling invasions from France and from Irish nationals. The estate is occupied today by descendants of the original family and hosts chamber music festivals in summer. It is open to the public in order to raise money to cover the costs of upkeep and continuing restoration. The outside gardens are in the Italianate style, imitating the palazzos seen in Europe.
Eat all my banana.
Just outside Bantry is the lovely Seaview House. We'll spend a night here before continuing our exploration of the Beira Peninsula. Of course, we had to film the local wildlife, like these harbor seals in Bantry Bay.
Music.
Competing with Kinsale for the top tourist and culinary town in this part of Ireland is the colorful town of Kenmare. Founded in 1670 by Sir William Petty, most of the buildings date from the 19th century. After taking morning tea, we'll head off to explore the Kerry Peninsula. Our destination is Valencia Island, where we'll take a boat to the mysterious Gaelic Islands. According to Irish legend, the king of the world visited these islands in the 2nd century. There are dark skies and rain is forecast for today, a perfect setting to visit these islands. Two rocky peaks situated offshore in the Atlantic Ocean. Weather conditions won't allow us to climb the peak. Skellig Michael, the largest of the islands, is a well-preserved monastic outpost of early Christianity. Built in the 7th century, it is perhaps the best-preserved early Christian island monastery in the world. The monks lived in stone beehive huts, perched above nearly vertical cliff walls. The monastery on Skellig Michael survived a Viking raid in 823 and was significantly expanded with a new chapel around the start of the second millennium. It was finally abandoned about a century after that. Small Skellig is home to 27,000 pairs of gannets, the second largest colony of these birds. The islands are a World Heritage Site. Overlooking the Atlantic Ocean with lush woodlands nourished by the warm Gulf Stream, Park Sanilla has been welcoming guests since 1895. And we're spending the night here with dinner at the luxurious Pygmalion restaurant. George Bernard Shaw, a frequent visitor to the hotel, wrote much of the play St. Joan while vacationing here. The Victorian architectural features of the hotel combine with the opulent furnishings to create an atmosphere of gracious luxury. We've been cold all day, and there is no better way to warm up than with an evening cocktail in this lovely bar. Dunlow Gap was formed when Ice Age glaciers receded, leaving rugged rock outcroppings, a diverse landscape, and several scenic lakes. We traversed the gap in a horse-drawn trap, passing over stone bridges, through lush fields, and by quiet lakes. Legend has it that the last serpent in Ireland hid here until St. Patrick tricked it into slipping into a box with the promise that it would be released. That box still resides on the bottom of Serpent Lake, waiting for the day that will never come. We're on our way to the lovely and historic Killarney National Park, Ireland's first national park, comprising 26,000 acres of wooded forest and lakes. The focal point of the park is the Muckross House, a restored 19th century mansion with its world-famous gardens and arboretum. It was built between 1839 and 1843 by Major Henry Arthur Herbert and was designed by the great Scottish architect William Byrne. He was forced to sell the property to a member of the Guinness family in 1899 after he ran into serious financial difficulties. In the mid-1960s, the house, which has since been magnificently restored, was opened to the public. Ross Castle, situated right on the lake, is a typical example of the stronghold of an Irish chieftain during the Middle Ages. Built in the 15th century by one of the O'Donoghue Ross chieftains, it later housed a British garrison until it was returned to the descendants of the owners after the end of the British occupation. Before we call it a day and leave the Killarney area, we took a walk to see the Torque Mountain waterfall. It cascades 70 feet, crashing over rocks and boulders in one of the greenest places in the Emerald Isle. As rich in beauty as it is in history, Adare Manor is an architectural masterpiece of towers, turrets, and stonework ornamentation surrounded by breathtaking gardens. Majestic trees and fascinating ruins date back over 800 years. The legendary 18th century manor is perched along the River Maig, and has been lovingly transformed from a private home into one of the world's premier luxury resorts. Snuggled in a wooded and lush countryside setting, Adare is widely regarded as one of Ireland's most picturesque villages. Ornate thatched cottages line the main street. Adare means Ford of the Oak in Gaelic and dates back to at least the 13th century. Medieval monasteries and ruins exist a few hundred yards from the town center. Bunratty Folk Park is a living reconstruction of Irish life a century ago, complete with village shops and rural farmhouses furnished as they would have been at the time. The centerpiece of the park is Bunratty Castle, built in 1425. During the 16th and 17th centuries, it was an important stronghold of the O'Briens, kings, and later earls of Munster. Ireland is a delight for the photographer, and despite the often overcast weather, we were not disappointed. From the numerous medieval castles that dot the landscape, to the many restored manor houses and lodgings, to the ancient ruins and sweeping landscape vistas, we kept the camera rolling the entire time. But perhaps the greatest treat of all was our interaction with the Irish people. There was not a friendlier group on earth, and their cordial hospitality made this a very special trip.